Now, lots coming up this hour. We're going to take you to the border situation in New South Wales and Victoria, once Victoria is now out of lockdown, what it means for those communities. But firstly, a change of pace and some memories. Back in 2001, Melbourne trio Something for Kate released an album that certainly marked them out as one to watch. Who remembers this tune?
That was their 2001 hit, Three Dimensions. 20 years on, the band is preparing to go on a national theatre tour, part of a brand new concert series called Double or Nothing. And lead singer Paul Demspey joins us now from Melbourne. Paul, good morning.
Morning, Lisa. How are you?
I'm great. Look, I put it out there that you were on the program this morning, and gee, you've got some really intense fans who've got questions for you, so I'm going to have to give you a bit of a pop quiz at the end of it. But first of all, I just want to say congratulations. Can you believe that it is 20 years since Echolalia?
No, absolutely I cannot. I don't know where the time goes. You know, we've been busy. We've just been busy and here we are.
Yeah, so you decided to do the tour by basically performing the entire album for one set and then coming back on stage and giving everyone another set with new songs.
Yeah, well, basically, we haven't been able to go out on tour for so long that we wanted to give ourselves an excuse to be our own support act so that we could play two sets. We're just really itching to play. And we released a new album late last year that we, you know, haven't been able to play live yet. And at the same time, it's 20 years since Echolalia came out, so we thought, well, let's just go out and play them both.
How have you gone trying to feel creative in the situation that we've all seen over the last 18 months?
Look, you know, probably like a lot of people out there, I thought, oh, I'm going to have all this time, you know, to be creative and write songs and stuff like that. But, you know, the reality is that I've spent most of that time homeschooled.
Yeah, like so many parents. But do you feel, I know in the past, you know, you've talked about having writer's block, and I think you headed off to Thailand at one stage to, I think that was before you were writing Monsters, is that, if my memory is correct? And I mean, how do you break through writer's block if you ever get it anymore?
Well, yeah, I mean, back then, you know, I was young, you know, we were making this album, we were, you know, in our early 20s, and the songs weren't coming so easily, and your first instinct is, oh, you know, it's writer's block. And yeah, we did, we took off to Thailand and just sort of, you know, stopped thinking about music for a while, and then suddenly everything started to flow again. But I gotta say, you know, since then I've just stopped subscribing to the idea of writer's block at all, and I've just kind of realized that songwriting isn't as easy as maybe you think it's supposed to be, and that you just have to work really hard, and you might have to write for weeks and weeks and weeks and not come up with anything that you like, but eventually you get there. So, yeah, I just don't buy into writer's block anymore at all. I just keep on going until I get
so something. How much input do Clint and Steph have into the lyrics?
Into the lyrics, none.
They don't ask for any changes?
Not really. You know, I think sometimes they're even afraid to ask what the hell I'm on about. But but musically, you know, musically it's almost like being in a band with two record producers, because, you know, I sort of come in with these songs and then they like pull them apart and say, well, hang on, like, what have you thought about putting this bit there or changing that bit? So, you know, their input is of course, you know, crucial to what the finished product is. But my lyrics, I'm very, very kind of overprotective of.
Okay, well, here's one from the fan club out there watching. Do you name your guitars?
No, I do not. And I find it strange that you know, some people do that. No, they're pieces of wood.
Do you play the banjo?
You know, I don't think I've ever even picked up a banjo. I've never tried.
You don't want to learn?
I mean, I can't imagine it's too different to the guitar. I know that, like, the strings are tuned differently, but Yeah, sure. Why not? I'll go get myself a banjo.
Hey, you got to share with us, how on earth are you managing to rehearse getting ready for this this tour?
Well, tonight is the first one. So, I mean, you know, the tour's not till September, October, so we've got a little bit of time. But, yeah, there's been a few Zoom calls with band members and... Yeah, tonight is actually our first time getting together to have a crack at these songs.
So how has rehearsal gone, though, previously, or how do you do it over Zoom? Or, I mean, I don't know. It must be tough.
It's tricky, but especially with this tour, you know, because we're going to play the Echolalia album from start to finish, which, you know, we've never done. And a lot of these songs, you know, just haven't been played on tour that often, so we have to relearn them ourselves. So, and we have our friends Adrian and Olivia playing with us on this tour as well to sort of you know.
Can you give us a taste?
Am I
being
you a
cheeky?
Something, yeah. All right, okay. I was hanging upside down from the open past, waiting to discover something about the world. I couldn't get with the program and I couldn't listen to them. It was like trying to think in reverse. That's probably enough of that one.
Paul, that's awesome. That is such a treat for us, honestly. And doing it, you know, not having warmed up or anything, I think that's fantastic.
Well, the concerts won't be at 8:30 in the morning, so we'll be even more warmed up.
Hey, that would work for Michael and I. We might be able to go if you had concerts at 8:30 in the morning.
It would be a very exclusive performance.
Might hold you to that. Paul Dempsey, thanks for being on the program.
Thanks for having me. Cheers.